Assalamu alaikum and welcome to IHRC TV. Today we are joined by Mark Gonzales, writer, professor and narrative therapist, and also Arzu Merali, the head of research at IHRC and also a writer. We're going to be discussing post-Boston, post-Woolwich, the kind of reaction from the Muslim community, the reaction to the reaction of the Muslim community by these two distinguished guests. So if you start with you, Mark, what was your first reaction when you heard about the Boston bombings?
My first reaction when I heard about the Boston bombings was similar to the reactions I hear when I hear about tragedy anywhere in the world, which is, it's a shame that human life is taken. I don't discriminate when I look globally over what happens to people. And I feel that it's important to have a global heart. I just wish more people had it. I think some people are selective in their compassion. But when I heard about it, I thought about my friends in Boston. I thought about my friend who was actually running the Boston Marathon, who I did my master's in education with. And I reached out to people to find out how they were doing, who was on the ground, if anybody was harmed, and what the families needed, if anything, and what we could provide for support.
And you must have turned on the news and listened to, you know, what the newscasters and the reporters were saying. What was your reaction to that?
Ironically, actually, my first instinct when I hear something, whether horrible or beautiful, is going on in the world, is not to turn on the news. It's actually to either get on Twitter or to text people I know directly in the region and find out what's going on from their views on the ground in the eyes. And so that was my first thought, was what's going on, who's okay, does anybody need help, and what can we do?
Did you think that maybe these people were Muslim, you know, the attackers? Did that cross your mind?
No. For me, human beings do crazy things across the planet, regardless of identity. And I think that people only put a spotlight on identity when they want to try to point a gun or a certain policy towards a group of people versus addressing the larger general problems that were going on in our planet, in our society.
Were you worried about the reaction?
Yes, that actually I was. I remember sending out to both friends in the social media and on personal spaces, if you're brown, black, bearded, or wear a turban, just take care of yourself. Be with other people. Don't be alone in the streets right now. It saddens me that we live in a world, or even societies, or even nations, or even cities, that where you have to take that kind of precaution, where you worry about just the beautiful way in which you're born, walking down the street can actually impose like some sort of violence upon it. But that was, to me, the thing for people I knew, was just like, yo, take care of yourself. There's crazy people out there, and there's bigots out there, and there's ugly people out there who will want to do harm to you for no other reason than you're brown, black, with a beard or with a turban.
Also, that's an interesting reaction. Mm. The Islamic Human Rights Commission put out a warning after the Woolwich attacks.
Yeah. Sadly, that warning was nothing new. We've been putting that warning out after these big flashpoint incidents, which sadly are flashpoints because they are hyped up in the news by government, by the police, etc., in a way not to diminish from what has happened in those incidents, but unfortunately without reference, without context, Woolwich was a brutal stabbing, and was described as terrorism. We had a hate crime 2 weeks earlier, very similar, in Birmingham, against an elderly Muslim man. Which went unremarked, and yet, in terms of the nature of the crime, very similar. They had certain motivations which were beyond just the act of violence, etc., etc. And we knew it. As soon as I heard it on the news, as I was driving, taking my children home, my heart just sank, because we've been here so many times now. And the initial advice that we put out back in 2001, which is being put out now after 7/7, after various different crises, Madrid and so on and so forth, actually came to us in part from the States in the post 9/11 trauma of communities facing all sorts of backlash. And I think the really, really sad part of all of this is the fact that not only are we in the same situation, in many ways I think I felt this time it was qualitatively worse really much, much worse. I think the sense, the beleaguered sense of the Muslim community in the United Kingdom is really, really palpable now. There isn't even a kind of attempt to speak of anything except for what is being directed at us. So we were rushing out to condemn and to disassociate, and actually, in many ways, I feel sadly making the situation worse, because by trying to disassociate and repeatedly doing so, you end up associating. But that kind of necessary spirit that's needed to actually try and create a completely different narrative and break out of this vicious cycle isn't there. And as far as sort of the general community goes, I don't blame them. You know, we're year in, year out, kind of a very depressed state.
It's been over 10 years since 9/11, and the reaction between the states and the UK have been very similar in terms of the anti-Muslim hatred and the reaction of the Muslim community. But why do you think we haven't moved on as a community? And that's at both at first Arzu and then Mark. In terms of the response or putting confidence within our communities to be able to say, okay, look, I don't have to condemn, I don't have to apologize, because it has nothing to do with me. Care about human life, but why should we specifically as Muslims have to condemn or apologize? Why do you think that the Muslim community hasn't moved on?
I don't think there's a simple answer to it, although we can make some generalizations with caution. But I think, sadly, we haven't really been able to escape the identities that have been put on us, as opposed to developing our own identities. You know, we always talk about Ummah and the one Muslim nation, which is a wonderful idea, and also our love for the oppressed, essentially, to help all the peoples of the world. Believe the Prophet was Rahmatul Alameen, and yet we find ourselves divided at all sorts of levels by our ethnicities, our languages, our castes, if we're from certain parts of the world, gender, sectarian issues, unfortunately, all play a huge part in our narrative. And when we actually speak or act as Muslims, it's actually in these little sort of fractured, rather lonely ways, which have no effect except for in our own minds sometimes, frankly. And that's at the sort of civil society leadership level. This is not about people who don't put the mantle of representation on themselves. And I talk about even organisations like ourselves who can get carried away being taken to be representatives, when actually we don't have that kind of right to say that.
Mark, is it any different in the US in terms of the Muslim reaction or the community being able to move forward and not have to distance themselves from such actions?
Well, I think one of the things that I try to caution against is talking about the Muslim community in a nation like the U.S., because the U.S. itself is 300 million people. And I think to talk about any nation as a homogenous identity, much less even subgroups within that as homogenous identities, is part of the problem. Is that we forget that no human being is a clone of another human being. You know, we definitely have echoes of cultural values and ideas and visions and dreams, as well as, you know, specifically as those who follow paths of Islam. Because we also have to remember that even within Islam, there are multiple paths. That even though we have these echoes, there's a lot of differences too. What I did see within some of those groups who are more vocal about both being Muslim, and then there are those who are then like, well, as Muslim, quote, hyphen American, wanting to speak out and say that what happened was wrong and that that doesn't represent us. I think those are just really common sense statements. Is yes, what happened was wrong and that doesn't represent us. But I find that there's a very much damage that happens when the only time you speak about yourself is the time something has gone wrong, and to say that's not me, because what you have done in the minds of an audience, like as a person who deals with audiences and who deals with messaging campaigns, is that you have instilled in people that that's your identity, because the only time you're being shown are in times of tragedy. Not in times of laughter, not in times of love, not in times of vision, not in times of dream. And if we look at time beyond this specific like historical moment and say that this type of reality has been going on for centuries, that I think in one level we have normalized our speaking about ourselves only in the defensive, that that's almost all our community knows how to do. And by our community, I'm not necessarily just speaking about, quote, the Muslim, but all those who have been excluded from spaces of social narratives and of discourse and of movies and cinema and literature. I mean, we come from cultures that have rich traditions of language and verse and creativity. Why is it that we only spotlight what we are not? That's very damaging to human being, and it's very damaging to grow up in that type of environment. And so for me, that's what I saw within the States, is a bunch of people who came out about what they were not. And I'm like, I don't need to know what you're not. People don't need to know what you're not. I need to know who you are. Specifically, I don't believe in friendships based upon I'm not that, I'm not that. That's a horrible way of living life. You know, I don't know when this entered into our cultural DNA, or when it was forced into our cultural DNA. But I do know that it needs to change if we're going to grow dreamers and leaders versus people with timid spines.
I think you picked up on a really important issue, and that is that we are only shown to be saying these things at this time. And I think the critique that I have of a lot of the acts of defense, as you said, which are necessary, but at the same time are the only things that are shown, is that actually we don't understand that this space of the media or the public platform that we get at this time is not a value-free space. So we have an idea that, okay, if only we show ourselves properly in the media, okay, then we can be understood, all right? But we are not shown. And the kind of deeply ingrained structural injustices within all these institutions is not something that, sadly, I think leadership, without wanting to overly generalize, but unfortunately that's how it's going to come out, just are not savvy to, okay? And that is the worry for me, that being in the United Kingdom 30 odd years down the line of things like the Tottenham riots, Tot's death, going through the Rushdie affair, so on and so forth, that the sort of structural problems with regard to media, police, and so on and so forth just don't seem to be acknowledged. If anything, we're going backwards. We're kind of living in that post-racial dream that's being pushed onto us, which is that we fixed racism. There are just individual racists around, and actually they're not such a big problem as this huge, supposedly amorphous and, you know, never-ending terror that comes from Muslims. We have bought into that.
Why do you think it is, both in the US and the UK, that Muslims are only ever shown, like you said, distancing themselves or telling people what they are not, and not, you know, occupying that space?
I don't think it's just Muslims. I think maybe it's de rigueur for Muslims at the moment. But, you know, we've been here before many, many times. And I grew up with massive demonization of what we now call black communities. And when I was growing up, we were all black. But I'm talking about, in the UK context, West Indian communities. In every possible terrible way, and also the Irish community as the terrorists of choice at that time. Now the focus is on Muslims. You know, we haven't reinvented the wheel here. Yes, there are obviously some particularities and whatever, and the whole geopolitical strategy and so on, but we just fell in the understanding of how institutions serve political agendas.
Have you got better at it? Have we got better at it in terms of, you said that this isn't something new. Do you think we, and again, I'm generalizing here, doing what you said not to do is to generalize the Muslim community, but you know, are we better at it? Are we better at countering this kind of narrative that we find ourselves in if it's happened before?
I would say that one does not shift a narrative by countering a narrative. One shifts a narrative by authoring another idea or story that looks so imaginative, it reveals the existing one for what it is, painfully bigoted. And as long as you're trying to counter, then you're buying into this kind of binary way of being, that it has to be this or that. And all you do then is define your entire identity in opposition to something. You know, and I mean, if you get into both social theory, philosophy, and physics, there's an entire like framework around that, like whether you look at dialectical materialism, whether you look at Foucault's concept of othering, you know, it's this idea of like, this is how human beings construct identity, by defining themselves in opposition. But that's not true. That's only how certain societies have done it. And so when you talk about, though, how long has this been going on, you know, I really think back to the writing of Foucault and Fanon. And I think about really at the core what these two psychoanalysts were doing was saying, when in society did there enter this idea that there's a wrong way to be human? With Foucault very much trying to deal with both sexuality and mental health within European society and how people were literally put into prisons, prisons of the mind called mental institutions, and being told you're being wrong and experimented on. And then Fanon doing that with the racial analysis. Later, Ansel Dura doing it both with gender and sexuality. But and this core idea of like, where did it enter into certain society's idea, like gene pool, that there's a wrong way to be human? And if you're being human wrong, then we're going to fix you or we're going to remove you. And that to me was the core issue. When you look at their writings later, then you know they're actually trying to deal with what are the effects of that type of discourse and that types of social and psycho environment on human beings. How do we understand addictions and suicide and self-harm in that type of psychosocial reality of what people are going through, of being told you're wrong. Not you're wrong that you have a different opinion. You're wrong for 2 + 2 is it, and you're like, it's 5. Not like those type of you're wrong, but just because you breathe within the body you do, you're wrong. You walk down the street and you're living wrong. It's like, where does that come from? And I think that has to be the core question, because otherwise you're always trying to respond to something. Instead of saying, I'm not the sick one. The sickness is this idea which tells me there's a wrong way to be human. That's what's wrong. Because as long as you're not addressing that core issue, then we're forever just, you know, either playing the blame game, or you're waiting for that wheel of misfortune to change its flavor of the month.
Can you relate to that? You know, either you know, you're wrong. There's something wrong with you. We're going to remove you. That kind of analysis of, say, society or a certain kind of people.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything to really argue about there. This idea of being able to say we're not the sick ones. That's where my worry is. I mean, we did a lot of research. We used Kramerite, the idea of the muted group theory. When we were doing research in the United Kingdom on Muslim expectations rather than their experiences. We've done a lot, and we still do a lot about, you know, discrimination, Islamophobia, racism, and so on and so forth, but we were more interested in what people want and what are their aspirations and how they vision society as a way of changing the story. A muted group was really important because it helped to explain the language that we have with each other without being, you know, this idea of a homogenized group, but what are the languages that excluded communities have and the way they talk. And this was initially developed with regard to gender. And then how we actually have to talk when we negotiate with power or when we talk in wider society. And that's a completely different language. We have to change what we're talking about. We have to change the terms we use and inevitably the content of what we talk about because we have to use somebody else's language, not as in a completely different language, or the English, whatever, but actually conceptual language, okay? And for us it was, okay, how do you get that, the voice of the muted group on their terms, not just out there, it would be very nice to just be on the BBC for a day, that's all well and good, and then everybody forgets about you, but how do you get those ideas to change society, to break out of the muted, or to break through the muted barrier? And that was the mid-noughties, we're in 2013 now, and when we're doing similar sorts of research, we're struggling to find that different narrative because people are either scared to talk to some human rights commission or to researchers or people who, you know, in theory they should be able to empathize with or have the same conversation with. They are now sort of reproducing this narrative which, as you said, has become normalized. Okay, so we're now talking about supporting troops, and the arguments are, what's the best way to support troops and what's the best thing to say about it, okay? you can understand people being politically beleaguered and saying that in an external conversation, but why are we having that conversation? Anybody who says anything critical is almost thrown out of the community. Okay.
Are you talking about muted groups here, for example? The Muslim community sometimes, the grassroots Muslim community, or communities that the establishment doesn't really engage with, having their voice heard, but without compromising, because I think what we've seen from many Muslim organisations, at least in the UK, is that when they get to a certain level, or it's just all about getting that seat at that table to have those discussions with the politicians of who they can rub shoulders with and who they can potentially influence. But, you know,
but influence them to do what? That's the question. I mean, we've sort of bought into the idea of lobbying, particularly in the United Kingdom, but what is it that you're lobbying for? Because all the sounds that are coming out, it's not specifically a Muslim thing. I think a lot of the minority communities have been going through the same problems, which is, you know, to get heard, you have to say X. The point is, once you say X, what's the point of being of speaking? Okay? And we haven't really been able to fix that, which in many ways is not our problem, but that's a structural problem. But then we've actually even stopped saying the things which are different. And, you know, it's not just about us protesting about war, it's about what kind of world we want to live in. You know, we have a huge crisis with schools in the United Kingdom, with the health system, with all sorts of things, you know. It might be that we just want to talk about, you know, things the same way with regard to the National Health Service, but we might actually have different ideas about caring for people who are ill.
Saying something different.
Exactly.
Saying something different, Mark. You know, you say something different. At least to us, listen to in the UK. But how is that received amongst your Muslim peers in the US, or those that seek to engage with politicians, like we've just explained, try to get that seat at that table, or to rub shoulders, or try to seek to influence?
Well, I find what's interesting is the concept of rubbing shoulders, which is coming into, which even as a metaphor means you're having direct contact with the person. So I want to have a relationship to a position of power. And I think we have to be clear when we define power, at least the way I look at it, it's the ability to affect life expectancy, whether on an individual level or a collective level. So we're talking about how do we change the rate at which certain groups or identities end up in an early grave while other people live long and full lives. And then both in terms of life expectancy, then we're looking at quality of life within that. And so I think there's nothing wrong with saying, I want to increase my loved one's life expectancy. I think what happens though, and this is to get into kinds of, I guess you could say a reflection or a diagnosis of an issue, is that the only way that we can construct that is then to surround ourselves by those who we feel have the ability to affect our life expectancy. And to me, what that is a result of is of a wounded imagination. That the inability to construct or envision a future that is different than the one you live in is the sign of a traumatized mind. And I think that's what we have to go to. When you ask, how do people receive that? It varies. I mean, I'm a firm believer, I don't go to communities I'm not invited to. I don't want to kick it with people who don't like me. I'm like, I have no desire to convince a bigot to stop hating me. I think that's, life is short. Our time span of our souls is infinite, but our life in this span is short. And so why do I want to waste my time trying to convince someone who wants to harm me not to harm me? Every second I spend with that is not spent growing people I love or growing the world that we actually deserve. And there are those who that message resonates with. There are those who those skills of storytelling and healing that they desire and I sit with and we talk about how can we grow ourselves and grow different spaces. And there are those who have invested not only their life but their livelihood in a different way of constructing a future. And to for them to shift the trajectory of this boat right now, they've invested too much in it. And that they're not willing to do that. And I'm like, fine, if that's your path, then let that be your path. What I do need from you is to not try to sabotage my path. I don't need you to join me. If you're going forward, word, I have no idea what the future looks like. I wish you the best in trying to create a better world for people. Alhamdulillah, however it happens. What I don't want you to do is try to sabotage me because I'm trying to do it in a different way.
Is that what happens?
I think this is how we're conditioned to. That there's only one way to grow a new world. And I think because certain groups pull from the same resource pool, that they're then turned into competition and opposition with one another. And I think that part also has to do with the lack of imagination, is that we get into grant-dependent organizations, and therefore our only way of constructing the economic resources necessary to grow a new future become competitive with one another. And when we're coming from the same community and we're trying to grow a better world, competition isn't what's needed, cooperation is.
Sister Arzu, you touched upon an interesting point about communities drawing upon the same resource pool and then ending up competing with each other.
Yeah.
Before 9/11, I'm not sure, I was still a kid, I'm not sure how many Muslim organizations there were, but if you look after 9/11, post 7/7, there's a plethora of Muslim organizations,
yeah.
And sometimes it does seem, at least from where I'm sitting, that they're in competition with each other. Now, you're obviously head of research at Islamic Human Rights Commission, you have more of an insight than I do.
I don't know whether my insight would be particularly better than anybody else's on this. I think I would be wary of being critical of the dependency that a lot of Muslim organizations have in the United Kingdom, at least, particularly on government funding, just because they're not going to get it. I mean, the Muslim community is very good at giving money for orphanages, for feeding people who are starving, etc. And that needs to be like that. But it still hasn't quite gotten around to, or building mosques, but it hasn't quite gotten around to understanding that sometimes you need to build projects or organisations, you know, investing in projects with youth particularly is something that I think we're just about getting into now. And so every time a funding run comes from the government or from local authorities, and in the last 5 to 7 years, they've all been tied to the security discourse and so-called anti-terrorism programs like PREVENT. You know, I really don't blame people if they want to get a pool table or whatever it is for their local, or if they're going to get the money from there. They have to. Where else are they going to do the work that they do? And I think a lot of people do it knowing the problematic of it, but just having very little choice. For me, the bigger crisis we have at the moment, rather than the organisations just scrapping it out, it's actually the kind of, if you like, a kind of ideological bankruptcy that we have, and that it is a competition, but it's not about the resources, it's about who's the right Muslim, okay? And that is resulting in a sectarianism, which is essentially being, you know, promoted externally, and we've just internalised it. So whenever anything bad is going on, you're saying it's not me, but you're also trying to say, but we're the good ones. And when we have a conversation about Islamophobia, anti-Muslim racism, we are actually saying, well, yes, you're blaming, you know, you're demonizing us because of X, Y, and Z, but, you know, please understand that we also know those people are bad, okay? We are the ones who are the good ones. Don't demonize us, as opposed to don't demonize whether it's Muslims or anybody else, okay, or otherwise. We're basically saying that process is okay, just know that we're one of you. And I think that's where we've got stuck into, and we've descended into this very rapidly, I think partly because of international events, but really uncritically over the last few years. And at least in the UK, I can't speak beyond that, I think we are in a crisis. You know, you spoke about wounded imagination, or whether it's poverty of imagination, or however you want to describe it, it's a very critical stage that we're at. We're at a situation where we, you know, I can go on somebody's Facebook page and talk to people saying, yes, genocide that lot, and that's fine, and nobody's getting blocked.
Yeah. You said in terms of, you know, people saying we're one of you. Why is it such an issue with someone born in this country? Not many, you know, their parents or their grandparents may be from Pakistan or India or Kashmir or wherever, not having much of a link to that. So they associate with the identity of the UK. So they feel like, you know, we are one of you. Why do you have an issue with that?
I don't have an issue with whatever anybody wants to be. I mean, I was born in the UK, but I still don't, like many of my peers, support the English football team. or the cricket team. And maybe I'm just being getting old and remaining a bit perverse, whereas, you know, people like Gary Young, who are the same generation, have kind of changed their stance on this and so on and so forth. But, you know, if that's what you feel you want to belong to, that's fine. What I have concern about is where you buy into the political violence wholeheartedly, or because you feel you just have to be accepted, okay? If you really are a part of this, and we can be part of it without supporting the England cricket team or listening to this or that, or doing both. We don't have to take the violence with it. Okay, we need to be rejecting that and changing that and coming up with alternatives. And that's where the panic is. I mean, that's really where, you know, you turn on the radio and you hear the most sort of quote-unquote respected mainstream broadcaster talk about attackers of Muslim appearance. I just wonder whether you woke up in 1974. Big deal. Right? It's like being in 1974 and listening about, you know, well, I can't even repeat the words that we used to be used to.
Muslim appearance, Mark. Muslim appearance, the two attackers in Boston weren't exactly what the stereotypical, you know, the idea of Muslim appearance. That threw America a bit.
I would say that increasingly, as we become a multimedia generation, that the ability to read not only physical words, but visual words and visual language critically is continually on the decline. And so the ability to understand that people look different across all places of this planet, even within certain geographic regions, and that there can be multiple religions and faiths, as well as traditions, dialects, ways of being in a specific place, seems to be lost on a lot of people. There was a website called Public Shaming. I think it's a Tumblr site. And one of the things that they were spotlighting, they spotlight like when people put out racist or bigoted or sexist ideas, and then they'll show like people's actual tweets, even if they try to delete them. So that way it's like, oh, public shame. So one of the things that Public Shaming was doing was, where were the bombers from?
Chechnya.
And what does that kind of sound like?
Czechoslovakia.
Right, so there were thousands of people who were like, nuke Czechoslovakia on Twitter. Like literally be like, F, it's the Czechoslovakians are attacking us. We need to go invade them. So when you talk about like, oh, are people like, do they get maybe the wrong ethnicity? I don't even think that people are no longer cognitive on a lot of levels of what ethnicity means. It's a construct. Race is a construct. You know, as Sahel Dalatsai, you know, said, you know, when he was here several weeks ago, is how do you address something that is a biological construct but a social reality? You know, and when we speak to that, how do we speak to it in ways that doesn't reinforce the construct and perpetuate and project it into the future? So did people get it wrong? Yeah, people were confused. Think the same way goes, oh, you're, you know, to me, I'm Chicano, I'm indigenous, but to most people, they're like, oh, you're Mexican. You know, you're Mexican and you're Muslim. Does not compute, like in brain. Like, and you almost see, it's like the little cartoon flames like starting to explode, the steam coming out of their head of like, what do you mean? Like, you can't be both of these things at the same time. It's because we have a very limited understanding of human identity or what constructs human identity from social, structural, and cultural spheres. And where do they intersect? And how do we unpack that in ways that makes it meaningful to us? So do people get it wrong? Absolutely. I think that was one of my fears, actually, in the days after, you know, the bombing. But I kind of also want to hesitate, like, this continual returning to the bombing. Because one of the things that I was doing statistically in the days after the Boston bombing and the arrest of the accused killers of the attack was there was about 5 days, you know, between when the bombs went off and when an arrest was made. Within those 5 days, if you look statistically inside the United States, about 2,500 people attempted suicide, because over 1 million people documented attempt suicide in a year within the United States. There's an act of sexual violence every 2 minutes within the United States, which is 5 times greater than India, actually 10 times greater than India, even though we're 1/4 the population. You know, so within that time, there were over 3,500 acts of sexual violence. My concern is for safety of people across the board. And as long as we only focus on incidences that are spectacles, we're missing what's really killing people across this planet. 26,000 children, meaning under the age of 14, die on this planet every day from diseases that are preventable. We're having all the wrong conversations. If we're concerned about human life, let's be concerned about human life. Why are we ending up in an early grave? And let's look at it statistically. What's putting us there? And what are the core reasons for that? Instead of investing all this money into something that statistically is really a small percentage of why people die prematurely on this.
Interesting point. One soldier died, Lee Rigby was killed. That's one life. And it's not like it's a competition for who's lost the most life, but human life is human life. What do you think about the reaction in the UK specific to that? And for example, the failure of Muslims and Muslim organizations, again, generally speaking, to highlight A, the causes of radicalization, and B, the deaths that take place across this country and across the world, whether it's from poverty or war waged by, you know, Western countries.
I'm well known for this, and I often talk about the failure of Muslim leadership, etc., etc. One of the things I want to sort of put a bit of context around that, and again, it's as a result of a lot of the work we've been doing in the research side, particularly following Professor Amelie's lead on this, about how social structures are imbued with certain hatreds and prejudices, etc., etc. And so, as much as I will call out where I see leadership fails, at the end of the day, these are all the outputs of the structure. You know, they're not just sitting there being, if you like, stupid in isolation. You know, they are under all sorts of pressure to come up with this. And, you know, when it comes to being stupid, under pressure or not, you know, I have to look at myself first and the work that we do. But, you know, as much as that reaction is important, it's about the understanding of how those structures work. So without wanting to kind of endlessly repeat, I think this is where we really need to grapple hold of this, okay? And one of the things that we really need to do, it's pigeon steps, you know, we have to kind of just find ways of breaking out of this. And I think it's about, I use the word hesitatingly because it's now become a loaded term, solidarity. We just need to move beyond our personal traumas that are created by these, if you like, you know, spectacular incidents, which we understand all the positions of, okay? But these are not just happening to us, they're happening all around the place. We had uprisings or riots or whatever you want to call them 2 years ago in the United Kingdom. Now, for a community that understands very well and is very good at articulating how they've been demonized by the media, I still don't understand how they were not able to see other types of demonization happening in the media during those events. Okay, so there was a sort of whole-scale demonization of black people, okay, of youth across the board, because after 2-3 days you could no longer say this is something about ethnic minorities. You had to concede that actually it's young people of every single shade or hue or however you want to describe it in the United Kingdom. Why is it that we can't actually see that for ourselves? And, you know, you saw all sorts of, I would say, aggressive and offensive statements coming out of Muslim leadership. So now in that situation, what pressure were you under to condemn? Okay? Really, no. I mean, either be quiet or say the right thing. Okay? So this is, I think, these are some of the practical challenges we have. We do have to re-envision the world, and we do have to have the confidence to do that. But at the very least, we have to stop doing the damage. Mark referred to it earlier. Okay? Don't sabotage somebody else's way of doing it. And rather than just talking about how we descend into sectarian or other types of competition and violence, whether it's physical or psychological between each other in the so-called Muslim community or communities, we actually also have to see the damage we're doing to our fellow people who are also excluded in this country. You know, I think we sometimes imagine that only Muslims are oppressed and not kind of understand, frankly, most people are. And one of the things that Professor Armani has been very good at in talking about how hate crime works within a context is that actually even mainstream communities who might also as individuals be perpetrating acts of violence in a way are also victims of the structural violence that actually pushes people to enact things like this, okay? They don't just wake up one morning and decide they're gonna burn down a mosque. They've been sort of loaded with negative imagery about Muslims, okay? They've been pushed by the kind of rhetoric that's going on, and that's why we get up and do things. We need to be interacting at that kind of level, at the very basic level, if we're gonna start going forward anywhere.
Mark, final words from you, just picking up on the idea of solidarity and kind of breaking out and, you know, realizing that the Muslims, at least in the UK and the US and around the world, are not the only oppressed group.
I would say, first and foremost, what does it mean to love yourself? Because I think people aren't even in solidarity with themselves. Meaning that a lot of times we support policies, actions, language, discourse, and stories that are harmful to our even own bodies. And by harmful to our own bodies, it doesn't only mean creating a social environment that can be very volatile where anything can happen. It can mean that there's actually physiological effects to not being in control of your own discourse. And then even if you look at, say, early childhood education, what happens to children who are prevented from speaking? It damages them. You know, human beings are also meant to have touch. So when you remove these elements from people, the ability to speak, the ability to express with each other freely, you're actually damaging them psychologically, which then has a physical response to that. So I'd say, first off, how do we be in solidarity or in alliance with ourselves? Meaning not contributing to things that damage us. And then how do we expand that circle to also looking like, okay, it's not just about me on this planet. You know, it's about how do we construct the world that we're actually meant to live in? And what do we deserve, both as a culture as well as a species? And as you grow that, you look at what is injustice and how is it being done to other people? And no human being deserves that. You know? If you really think it at the core, how do we grow what we want for ourselves, for other people, and also listen to what other people want for themselves, so we're also not becoming imperialist in our ideas of transformation. But we're really understanding like, wow, there can be multiple ways of being, and multiple structures, and multiple spaces, and multiple cultures, and multiple prayer, and multiple language on this planet that doesn't have to invade one another. Because at the core, that's what we have to go back to, is being like, how is so much of what we're dealing with just the echoes of invasion and displacement that we've normalized? And when you normalize, you no longer question it. You've actually absorbed it as reality. And so you stop imagining that there can be other ways of being.
On that note, Mark, Arzu, thank you very much. Hopefully tune in for more on our YouTube channel, IHRC TV. And thank you. Assalamu alaikum.